So it just that's why it's just still in the vibes, but we are taking early morning class, so let's not be very lazy. Let's be a little bit active, and I'll start the class. People are joining, I'll join in between. Okay, so today's topic is enteric fever. Other names for enteric fever are typhoid, Ebert disease, salmonella fever. It includes a fever caused by Salmonella enterica var typhi, enteric fever caused by Salmonella enterica var paratyphi, ABC. Paratyphoid fever accounts for 20% of all the enteric fever worldwide. So Salmonella enterica typhi paratyphi contain it's an enterobacteriaceae, gram negative. It's flagellate. Okay, flagella is there for movement. Anaerobic bacilli. It's an anaerobic. Okay. Somatic O antigen shared among various Salmonella, flagellar H serovar specific. So there are three antigens. I'll tell you in the diagram. So there is O antigen, H antigen, and VI antigen. Okay, so O is somatic, H is flagellar, and VI is surface virulence antigen. And there is lipopolysaccharide macromolecule complex called as endotoxin within the bacteria. Okay, so. So if you see the structure, see, so we have pili, known as pili. There is a flagellus. Then is capsule, the light blue color. Then dark blue color is cell wall. So plasma lemma, DNA inside the cytoplasm. See, so this is the structure. Regarding the antigens, I'll tell you. So Salmonella typhi and paratyphi are pathogenic exclusively in the humans. Okay, fecal-oral transmission is the mode of transmission. So when we eat dirty food contained with feces of person containing the Salmonella typhi, the patient gets the disease. So sometimes they can be chronic stool carriers. So sometimes some people can be shedding their Salmonella typhi in the stool chronically. So carriers may shed the bacteria even in the urine. Okay. So this is the state of our country. So many people taking bath in the river, same place. So this is the route of transmission. So if you see Salmonella under microscope, enlarged, so you have flagellated bacteria. Okay, flagella with bacteria. So if you see the pathophysiology, the infective dose is 1,000 to 1 million organisms. So you need a lot of organisms to get infected. After ingestion by the host, Salmonella typhi has to survive the gastric barrier to reach the small intestine. Now, it penetrates the mucosa of the intestine and then infects the lymphoid follicles, which are known as Peyer's patches at the ileocecal junction, basically. Finally, draining the mesenteric lymph nodes, liver and spleen. So it multiplies within the reticuloendothelial system, lymph nodes, liver and spleen. After incubation period for 7 to 14 days, they spill in the bloodstream, and this spill marks the onset of clinical features of enteric fever. Okay, so the all those story is beyond the fever. So this is, so after patient is, person is not washing his hands properly or drinking hygienic food and water, then this bacteria has to tolerate the gastric acid, and then it goes into the small intestine. In the intestine, at the junction of ileocecal junction, basically the bacteria enters the mucosa of the intestine, then goes into the lymphoid system. And because of the inflammatory response in the GI system, they may result in diarrhea during this phase. Still, fever is not there. So then by the infiltration, they reach liver, spleen, and bone marrow. And then after some incubation period of 7 to 14 days, the bacteria again comes back into the blood and it leads to the fever. Okay, so a lot of time has already passed, maybe 2 weeks to 3 weeks before the bacteria entered the body and giving you the symptoms. So the incubation period, the untreated typhoid fever may last at least 4 weeks. Incubation period is 7 to 14 days. During the incubation period, 10 to 20% of patients may have transient diarrhea because of enterocolitis. Diarrhea in children and immunocompromised is more common. Constipation in adolescents and adults are more common due to the Peyer's patches hypertrophy. So when it is invading at the ileocecal junction, the lymph nodes get enlarged. And because of that, in adults and adolescents, there can be constipation, not much diarrhea. But in children, diarrhea is very common. So in the classical sense, there may be high-grade fever, spiking fever, or hectic fever, we say that. Toxemia, the child will look very toxic. He will be having high-grade fever and child will not be able to sit properly. He will be sleeping and he will find that the child doesn't look good from distance only. Delirium, the child may have some kind of illusion kind of pain. He will not be well oriented to time, place and person. Okay, there can be dull aching abdominal pain. Constipation can be there, and when you examine, there may be hepatosplenomegaly again. So these are the things. If you find any of these things in the patient, you must suspect that it may be enteric fever. So in the first week, generally fever starts with low grade and show a stepwise increase. So stepwise increase means, so today it may be just 99 degree Fahrenheit. Tomorrow the fever may be 100 degree Fahrenheit. Day after tomorrow it may be 102 degree Fahrenheit. And in fourth, fifth day, it may be 104, 105 degree Fahrenheit. So the fever starts slow grade, low grade, and gradually increase to high grade. So constipation often develops early and is likely due to obstruction at the ileocecal junction by swollen Peyer's patches. Then there can be rose spot in the first week. So rose spots basically is difficult to find out in our community. So it's generally a small reddish spots, and they are not palpable. So they are basically seen at the abdomen and chest area. And they are because of embolic bacterial emboli and basically seen on the end of the first week of the fever. Relative bradycardia. This is sometimes clinically easy to suspect enteric fever. So relative bradycardia means, so whenever you have a fever, there is always tachycardia. So body makes compensation to remove the so for fever, it is compensation that the heart rate goes up. So, but in enteric fever, what happens? If you have high grade fever, still the heart rate will not be so high. So that's why it is known as relative bradycardia. It doesn't mean that it will be bradycardia. It will not, heart rate will not be less than 60, but according to temperature. So if temperature is 104, generally heart rate goes beyond 104, maybe 110, 120, okay? It will be definitely more than, heart rate will definitely be a little bit more than the temperature. But in this case, if the temperature is 104 degree Fahrenheit, the patient's heart rate may be 90. So less than the temperature. So that's why it's known as a relative bradycardia. Coated tongue. If you examine the tongue, there will be a thick white coating on the tongue, leading to decreased appetite, not feeling good taste in the mouth. So this is some signs. In the second week, the child's appearance will be toxic now. In the first week, the child's appearance is not toxic. The child has fever, but still child is active. In the second week, child becomes toxic, apathic. Child do not want to move around a lot. He wants to sleep. Sustained fever. So now the stepladder pattern has reached up to 104, 105 degree Fahrenheit in the second week. Abdomen is slightly distended because of the all those reactions in the abdomen. Gaseous distension can be there, or because of constipation can be there, a little bit distended. Soft splenomegaly. Now, in second week, spleen starts to enlarge, and we should always examine spleen when we suspect when we expect enteric fever. Okay, so spleen is very must examination. So even in the second week, you may have a soft spleen. You see, the child is now toxic and not really feeling good. In the third week, so this is a condition in which the patient is not taking any treatment, and he is just leaving himself, okay, without any treatment. Already 2 weeks have passed. So in the third week, the patient will be more toxic, anorexic. Now he is not going to eat anything. Tready pulse and tachypnea. Now the child is going to shock. Okay, so pulse is very weak, tready. Tachypnea, the child may have fast breathing. Pyrexia is still there, high fever is there. The state of apathy, the child is now a little bit confused. Sometimes he may have psychosis. He may tell that somebody is coming to hit him, some insects is running around his bed. So that's not a very good sign. It means the CNS is also being involved now. Pronounced abdominal distension. Now, abdominal distension will be very prominent. And he may have diarrhea, which is liquid and green yellow colored. Okay, that is earlier used to be said pea soup diarrhea. Okay, so if patient is left without treatment, he goes into very complications. So this is third week in which the most of the complications is seen. Okay, so enteric fever is a bacteria which do not leave any place of the body to affect. So all the organs of the body may be affected, and in third week, the child may be in a overwhelming toxemia, and it may lead to death also. The child may have myocarditis, pneumonia, okay, intestinal hemorrhage leading to blood in the stool, or if you check the occult blood, it may be positive. And sometimes there may be perforation of the intestine in this third week, and it's very common, enteric perforation. Pancreatitis can also lead to severe pain, abdomen vomiting, similar symptoms of abdomen. We should abdominal pain, we should not miss it, we should suspect pancreatitis. And meningitis, now even in the third, we already talked, it may lead to meningitis, orchitis, even in the bones, osteomyelitis, parotitis. So parotid glands infected, parotitis, polyneuropathy, the nerves may be affected, and polyneuropathy, focal intracranial infections. So small infections can be, so meningitis is infection of the meninges, focal intracranial infections is in the parenchyma. Multiple brain abscesses can be developed, polymyositis, muscles, in the muscles there is inflammation leading to some abscess formation. Immune complex glomerulonephritis, in the kidneys also it may lead to glomerulonephritis, encephalomyelitis. So now the spinal myelitis, spinal cord is also affected, and even with the parenchyma of the brain. Encephalomyelitis can be occurred in the heart. Pericarditis, now it's a little bit later or less. Pericarditis can be there, uveitis in the eyes, and in the hematological GIC can also be happening in this third week. So generally, if we have fever, prolonged fever, we should always suspect enteric fever, and we should try our best to cultivate to the 2 weeks period. We should try to diagnose it earlier. Okay, so if we see our diagnostic patterns, they definitely give you results within 7 days. So we should diagnose and treat it properly so that we have to avoid these complications. Because once complication is there, it's really difficult to treat, and the child may go into severe complications. So if the child is having a sickle cell disease already, child of sickle cell disease, and he got a salmonella sepsis, there can be swelling of the hands known as sickle cell decalitis with septicemia. Okay, so it's very dangerous for sickle cell people. brain abscess in the posterior fossa. If you see in the posterior fossa, this is brain abscess as a complication of salmonella meningitis. This is salmonella pneumonia with empyema. You see, on the left side. The right side lungs are better. On the left side, there is empyema. Osteomyelitis, salmonella osteomyelitis. You see, these are the bones. These are long bones. This is humerus. In the long bones, there is some punched out lesions, and in the femur, again, the features of osteomyelitis. Now, fourth week. Now, the patient is still untreated, and he reaches into the fourth week, and now, what happens now? If the patient has survived all those complications, then fever, mental scale, abdominal distension slowly will improve over a few days, okay? So if he can survive all those complications, definitely he will get better by itself. So intestinal complication may still be occurring on fourth week. There may be a lot of weight loss and debilitating weakness lasting for months because already he has not eaten anything and the bacteria has affected intestine so much. So he will be having a debilitating weakness. Intestinal perforation. So sometimes after fourth week, the intestine may perforate or even in the third week. So there, whenever there is a patient with history of prolonged fever and abdominal pain, severe abdominal pain, we should always do an X-ray, erect X-ray. Because in ultrasonography or in normal, because the patient is already very toxic and not able to sit properly. So in lying X-ray. If the patient is doing X-ray by lying, you will not be able to find this air under the diaphragm, and we will not be able to diagnose perforation. It will be very difficult, and it will be very late diagnosis. It will be diagnosed in the form of peritonitis later on. So we should do an erect chest X-ray, which can show you the air under diaphragm. And whenever you are checking this kind of X-ray, you should always look under the diaphragm on the left side. So on the right side, on the left side, already there is a gastric bubble. So we should not be much confused with that. On the right side, if you find air with a straight line, so gastric bubble will be differentiated. It will be a circular or not a straight line with like this. This is the air fluid level. Okay, the fluid, peritoneal fluid and air on the above. So we should always suspect. So we should be keen in observing this kind of X-ray. We will not be able to get it very prominently. We should search for intestinal perforation when we do an X-ray chest or X-ray abdomen erect. So the patient has gone into complications or not gone into complications and then has survived the 4 weeks illness. Okay, so still he has survived. Now he can go into a chronic carrier state. Even if he has been treated, he can go into a chronic carrier state. So permanent carrier is defined as individuals who secrete salmonella for more than 1 year. 1 to 4% of the affected individuals may go into chronic carrier state. The bladder infection with Schistosoma hematobium predisposes to urinary carriage. Okay? So Salmonella enterica survives in gallstones, greater incidence of cholecystitis in these patients, and the convalescent carriers may have carrier stage up to 3 months of age. Okay? 3 months after the infection. So if we do the investigation, basically in the first week, we do blood culture. So blood culture response will definitely come in 3 days to 1 week. So in second week, we will get the result. If the patient comes to you in second week, sometime we used to do a Vidal test. These days, Vidal test is not much reliable. We generally don't do Vidal test now. In the third week, we can do a stool culture to see for salmonella. In the fourth week, again, we can do a urine culture to see for salmonella growth. So in the later weeks, they are going into carrier state, so we can check that also. In the first week, we will not be much getting a stool culture positive, okay? So bone marrow culture is 95% sensitive. It's highly sensitive, but because it's painful, we don't do it all the time. So other investigations may show moderate anemia. ESR may be raised slightly. The platelet count will be on the lower side. Okay, thrombocytopenia will be there. Neutropenia, total counts will be less, but in that case, neutrophils also will be less, neutropenia, and lymphocytes will be more. Okay, relative lymphocytosis. So total count may be only 4,000, in which the neutrophils are less than the lymphocytes. So neutrophil may be 40%, 35%, and lymphocyte may be 75%. So you have to just have a mind that it may be enteric fever. And this is basically when we see in the first and second week. Liver enzymes and serum bilirubin will be raised twice the reference range. And in the third week, there may be features of DIC, okay, disseminated intravascular coagulation. So if you see, so earlier we already seen that there is sheath, okay, cell sheath, and then dark colored is a cell wall, okay, and on the cell wall is flagellum, okay. So on this outside sheath, there is a VI antigen. On this flagellum, there is an H antigen, and on the cell wall is the O antigen, okay. So basically in the Widal test, we test for these three antigens, and these three antigens tell us a little bit different things. So in acute infection, generally O antibodies appear first. So see, O is a cell wall. So whenever there is an acute infection, O antibody will appear first, and it will go first also, okay? So it appears early and goes early. So disappear within few months. While the H antigen means flagellar antigen, okay, H antigen. So while the H antigens, it appears late and it persists longer. So, and plus H antigen is zero or specific, okay? So H antigen can be used to differentiate between different types of enteric fever, okay? Serotypes different. So basically we are more having concern with O antigen and H antigen. Though VI antigen is also there and we check it, but more is H and O, cell wall and flagellum, okay? So if you get a titer of more than 1:80, it is diagnostic that it may be a enteric fever, like 1:160, 1:320, okay? And fourfold rise in titer. So basically, generally we should know the baseline titer of the patient. And if it is fourfold rise, then it is more significant that it is maybe a enteric fever. So why actually we don't use these titers these days is because they are not very specific, and they can be there when the patient is in a chronic state, isn't it? It is appearing and it's going to appear for a few months and even for longer time. So it doesn't, so whenever patient is coming to you with a fever and you are doing a Widal test, this antibodies may have been there for last 2 months, 3 months, when there the patient will not be having any fever. Now fever is for 1 week. So it may be something, a chronic state also. So we must be knowing the baseline. So if the patient has already done this titer 2-3 months back and his titer was 1:20 and now it is 1:160, so 4-time rise, then only it will be significant. But we generally do not have our baseline with our test, okay? And even if the patient is directly coming as 1:320, it may be just helping you, but it's not diagnostic, okay? And if we have vaccinated the patient with our typhoid vaccine, the O titers may be negative, but H titers may be positive, okay? So O means cell wall, H means flagellum. So the vaccine is basically more containing the H flagella antigens. So because of that problem, So these H positives may be there. So we will not be able to differentiate whether it is vaccinated person or a ill person, okay? So that's why we do not do a lot, but still if somebody asks in the question, we should be a little bit having an idea of what is Widal test, okay? So basically we are checking the three antigens, VI antigen, O and H antigen. O and H are more important. O comes early, goes early. H comes later and goes later also, okay? So cultures, basically cultures are the best to do diagnosis of enteric fever, we already know. Bone marrow culture is the best. Paint fever, don't do. Blood cultures may be positive in 75 to 95% of the patient, and they are the highly specific. Stool cultures may be positive a little bit later, even after in third week. And after the disease resolution, generally three stool cultures at 1 month apart should be taken to rule out the carrier state. Okay, so our disease has been improved and still we have to rule out the carrier state. Then we have to do three stool cultures 1 month apart. Other cultures can be cerebral. If the patient is in meningitis state, we are doing CSF analysis and we can do it culture for salmonella. Peritoneal fluid, mesenteric lymph nodes or rectal swab culture can also be done to rule out enteric fever. Punch biopsy samples from the raw spots can be positive in 65% of the people. Okay. So these are the techniques how they use to take the culture. Other investigations, you can do PCR for enteric fever, not very commonly done. X-ray abdomen for perforation, we have already seen. CT MRI if you suspect abscesses or something in the brain, space occupying lesion. Then we can do ELISA test, enzyme to detect IgG and IgM, still not much available. And now we have already diagnosed. But for prevention, we can always do a vaccination, okay? So we have two types of vaccines, VI capsular polysaccharide and typhoid conjugate vaccine, okay? So the polysaccharide vaccine was very common in our state for years. Now we have got a conjugate vaccine. The polysaccharide vaccine was a single parenteral dose, subcutaneous or IM, 0.5 ml. And it was recommended not below 2 years. After 2 years, you could use it. And the booster needed to be given every 2 years. Okay, so every 2 years we have to take a booster. But now the conjugate vaccine has arrived, which has a single dose, and this can be given after 9 months of age. But basically, still we because below 2 years the patient child is not eating from outside, the fecal oral contamination is very less in small children. But even if you suspect that they are having some endemic, they are living in endemic area and the hygiene is not good, we can advise them after 9 months of age. Okay, so now we are using typhoid conjugate vaccine. It has a lifetime immunity. So regarding the management, so good nursing care is very important. Taking care of the patient's nutrition. If he is eating well, then oral. If he is not eating well, then we have to give him fluids and electrolytes. Antibiotics. Controlling the fever is very important. And if you suspect that there is some CNS involvement, steroids, corticosteroids. And even if the patient comes to you in the shock, we can give steroids, dexamethasone, 3 mg per kg stat, followed by 1 mg per kg every 6 hours, 4 times a day. And then antibiotics. So antibiotics is the treatment of choice because it's a bacteria and a bacteria, flagellated bacteria. So what we do is chloramphenicol was the drug of choice earlier because of some side effects and resistance developed, so it got lost within time. But now chloramphenicol is again back because it's showing sensitivity now these days because it has not been used for years. Okay, cotrimoxazole is another, but we use it less. Ciprofloxacin is drug of choice in adults. Ceftriaxone, if you want to give IV, is drug of choice in the wards. We'll start it as a first line drug when we suspect enteric fever. And in children, we give cefixime prior to ciprofloxacin as a drug of choice. Okay, so if you see the total days we give, generally 7 to 14 days. Okay, so it depends upon the patient's response. Generally, we give a longer antibiotic course in case of suspected enteric fever or clinically enteric fever positive. Okay, other antibiotics, ampicillin can also be used IV for 10 days, or amoxicillin can be used for 14 days. Okay, ampicillin can be oral or IV, both. Now, these days, azithromycin is a drug of very commonly used for 7 days. It's a longer period. In viral or upper respiratory tract infections, we use this only for 5 days, but in enteric, we use it for 7 days. Uflox and nalidixic acid are another antibiotics. Okay. So along with that, if you find any complication, we have to treat the complications. We have to treat the carrier. So for treating the carrier, we basically use ampicillin or cephalosporins, means cefixime or ciprofloxacin, for add-on 4 to 6 weeks. Okay. So treat carrier, if you suspect carrier and is diagnosed as a carrier by a stool culture, we have to treat for longer time. So typhoid Mary, we all know why it is known as typhoid, because the typhoid Mary, she was a chronic carrier, she was a chef, and from her, this typhoid has spread to the community at one time. So that's why we remember her by her name. So thank you. Here I end my class. If anyone have any question, we can have a little bit of time, 3 minutes we have. So we can.